Bieszczowski, former head of the KGB in London, who started collaborating with the British intelligence in 1974. He was, by the early 80s, the most prized double agent working for the British. In 1985, he defected. 6 years later on, his wife, after having suffered constant surveillance by the KGB in Moscow, was allowed to join him. And she's now with him with his two daughters. That was, of course, due to the changes which swept the Soviet Union and made the Soviet Union no more. But my guest tonight, Oleg Gordievsky, also has a death sentence hanging over his head. And that death sentence still exists, doesn't it?
Yes, it does. Yep. In September last year, Yeltsin promised to some American journalists asking questions that he would review all ideologically motivated death sentences. So I'm still under death sentence. And I don't know why it didn't happen. I blame the KGB, but it may be not KGB at all, but just the Yeltsin government being very busy. Mm. Very busy with economic reforms and feeding the people.
Well, I would hope so, because that old Marxist-Leninist ideology has been swept into the dustbin of history. And surely, I mean, the KGB has been thoroughly reformed as well, hasn't it?
Not quite. Yes, the ideology, the communist ideology, have been swept away, yes. And the Communist Party of Soviet Union has been suspended. And it is a great achievement, and signifying that the democracy and liberal conditions are in progress in the former Soviet Union, now Russia. But the KGB is basically still the same KGB. The leadership, yes, they removed Mr. Kryuchkov, who is, of course, in jail because he one was one of the main plotters during that failed coup d'etat in August last year. Then they removed from the leadership about 26, I think, generals and colonels of the KGB. But 26, when the size of the KGB used to be 700,000, it's not, yes, huge, not a lot. So the KGB is still there. Only what happened, apart from some changes in the leadership, they split the KGB in a few independent from each other agencies. Mm. Like, for example, the chief directorate of border guard troops, immigration and border guard troops, it is independent now. Government communication services and troops, so they are independent.
It's impossible to reform it overnight.
No, it is impossible to reform it. The Yeltsin government is actually slightly reluctant to reform it at all, because KGB is, well, now it is a functioning and well-disciplined and uncorrupt organization. They used to be a secret political police of a totalitarian state, yes. Now the state has changed, and they're changing the tasks and functions of the KGB. But basically it's still the same old KGB, but it is well-organized. And that's why the government of Yeltsin thinks that it is still possible to use it, for example, to watch the social and political movements in the population and to predict riots.
Every government needs its secret service, doesn't it? Whatever political coloration it is.
Probably, yes. Only, of course, the secret service of the old communist Russia, Soviet Union, was too big, too huge, and it's still too big. That's why the question is whether it will be properly reformed one day, introduced or not. Mm. If it will be still the same KGB in size and more or less in its tasks, then the progress is very slow.
When you were a KGB colonel over here, when you first came here, what, in the early 1970s, did you? To work in the UK?
No, I was first posted in Scandinavia and first came to Great Britain in the summer 1982.
Now, people have a very romanticized image of what a spy does.
Yeah.
And the nature of the espionage business, if you like. What exactly was your function? What sort of information were you trying to get? What sort of people were you trying to subvert?
It was not the task to subvert people. The task was to recruit agents, informers for the KGB, who could explain to the KGB the policy of Great Britain, the secret, classified aspects of the policy and politics of the West.
So, right, recruitment. First of all, you're looking for people who worked in the civil service or near to the levers of power of government?
Yes, we were looking for politicians who had the possibility one day to become members of the government. Secondly, we were looking for members of the civil service, officials, who are, of course, in possession of secrets. Secrets about NATO, about relations with the United States, about strategic aspects, targets of Polaris missiles, for example, military secrets, and so on. But since it was very difficult to recruit officials,
yes,
the KGB resorted to easy tasks, like trying to recruit a journalist who would get something from his friends' officials.
Did you have any success in recruiting politicians, for example?
Very little success. Very little success. In Great Britain, the KGB was actually not as strong as it was and still is in many other countries. The fact was that in 1971, the British government expelled nearly the whole KGB.
Yes, yes, yes.
And since, the KGB had never recovered properly. The size of the KGB in Great Britain used to be something like 22, 24 offices only, with many different requirements and tasks. And they never managed to achieve big successes in the recruitment and penetration of the British government.
So you managed to get some success in the realms of the civil service, perhaps, did you?
I would say that the KGB was able to acquire a few useful contacts in marginal strata of the British society. An odd journalist, an odd member of a public organization, but not a single official, not a single important politician.
So basically, your job was to recruit people. It wasn't, you didn't do it very well, or you weren't very successful for various reasons.
No, we didn't. I apologize. I apologize on behalf of the KGB. We were not very successful.
Well, we'll break for a bit of music and back with Oleg Gordievsky in just a minute. Christopher Andrew has written the excellent, very interesting book, I must say, Instructions from the Centre, the Top Secret Files on KGB Foreign Operations, 1975 to 1985, the former head of the KGB in London, and a double agent. When you're working in the political sphere, trying to nurture contacts in British political life, you say you didn't have much success. What success did you have?
You know what? I usually don't speak about it. Because if I begin to speak about successes, then I have to speak about the personalities. If I speak about the personalities, I will have to name names. And if I name names, then I will offend people. And many people who were in touch with the KGB, they were not really KGB agents, informers. They were just contacts, friends, acquaintances.
Did they know that they were in touch with the KGB?
Usually they didn't. Usually they didn't. They spoke to Russian officials, to members of the embassy, to Soviet trade officials, not realizing that they were KGB. And that the KGB busily was writing reports about meeting them. Oh. They didn't know anything about
what
it.
What sort of information did they divulge?
Or the information which the KGB wanted, it was absolutely clear what kind of information. Strategic plans and secret aspects of British policy towards the East, towards China, towards the United States and so on. But as to those contacts, they were asked questions by KGB officers about it, and they said something, but what they said, it was really very little. Mm-hmm. And so the KGB, in order to be able to write and send back to Moscow political and analytical reports, had to, apart from using information, small bits of information received from those sporadic contacts, it added a lot of official information received from newspapers, magazines, specialized magazines, libraries, and so on.
So it's very, very innocent, really.
It was often very innocent, not always, because some of the... I speak usually when you ask questions about the KGB, I speak on behalf of the main direction of the KGB work, the political one. Mm. Because apart from it, there are, or used to be and still are in different, maybe in Britain as well, two other directions of the KGB work.
So when it wasn't innocent?
It was not innocent entirely, because, for example, in the sphere of scientific and technological secrets, which the KGB tried to acquire, the KGB did have some success and did recruit a couple of agents.
And did you pay these agents?
Yes, they were paid money.
Very well?
Sometimes well, sometimes less well. It depended on the circumstances.
And also, I would imagine it depended on their price, did it?
It depended on the, what kind of secrets they were able to acquire and to pass on to the KGB.
Because in the old days, and I know you've written about the, you know, the five men, Philby, Burgess, McLean, Blunt, and Cancross. In the old days, it was easy. You know, there were these fellow travellers in the 1930s who really did believe in the Marxist-Leninist ideology. But as the 70s and 80s progressed, those amounts of people got thinner and thinner on the ground. And so it became more important to actually pay people, because people, fewer and fewer people were doing it for ideological reasons, weren't they?
Yes, it is absolutely true. I happened to read the file on Anthony Blunt, and he didn't want to receive money, and the KGB forced money upon him.
Because he believed so much.
Because he believed in the ideals of communism, socialism, and Soviet Union, and Soviet policy. But eventually he started to get money, but slightly reluctantly. Yes, all right. So basically you're right. And after the events in Hungary in 56, and after the invasion of Czechoslovakia in 68, fewer and fewer people were ready to cooperate with the KGB because there were no idealists who were prepared to sacrifice their security or sometimes even life because of their belief in communism. There was no belief in communism.
By the 1980s, when most observers saw that the system was beginning to crumble, it must have been, money must have been of a very high imperative.
Yes, so the KGB paid money and wanted its agents to get to receive money from the KGB because money was not only a price and an encouragement, money was a means to tie persons, agents, closer to the KGB.
And blackmail, was that ever used?
Blackmail was used within the country itself, in Moscow. The internal KGB departments, they used blackmail quite often. But outside the country, KGB operating
abroad... someone's sex life or something like that?
Yes, like secretly photographing people in their hotel rooms and in their apartments, whatever they were doing, something sexual or exchanging currency or involved in buying and selling something illegally. Mm-hmm. It was documented and then they were confronted with the evidence and in a very rude and aggressive form and an recruitment approach would be made. Mm-hmm. And sometimes KGB was successful in recruiting people in Moscow. And later the KGB continued running those agents abroad, recruited on the basis of blackmail. But more and more in the recent years, it was becoming a rarity. Usually it was just money. Mm-hmm. Plus, of course, what became an interesting phenomenon in the 70s and the 80s, some people in the West, bored by their way of life, offered their services to the KGB because they were adventurous by nature and they wanted to have adventures in their life. And they became spies because they wanted to have thrill in their life. And it was also acceptable for the KGB.
My guest tonight is Oleg Gordievsky, former KGB colonel and double agent and... break for a record now. This is Carly Simon and became. Carly Simon and Oleg Gordievsky, former KGB colonel, is with me tonight, my special guest into the night. You say basically many of the contacts made with political sources in this country were fundamentally very innocent, but you still say you don't want to divulge any names. Why is that?
Yes, because I don't want to damage people who quite often and mostly were innocent victims of the KGB. KGB exploited them, KGB deceived them, KGB wrote reports about them, made files on them, and gave them some special names, pseudonyms or cover names, and there are files on them kept by the headquarters in Moscow. But so what? Usually they were just innocent contacts talking to the Russians, believing they were just innocent Russian diplomats or trade officials.
But to concentrate on the political side of it, people in political life, were they generally people on the left?
Frankly speaking, I'm not prepared to answer this question. It is already a sensitive question. I don't want to give hints about the left and right or center or whatever. I don't want to direct attention of the public towards some political corners.
Well, it would be unlikely if the KGB had managed to forge any links with the Conservative Party, wouldn't it?
If you read the newspapers recently, you would have found that everybody is reminding the public about the Cambridge Five and the others who represented the establishment.
Establishment, yeah.
So you see, theoretically and hypothetically speaking, it could have been anybody because the KGB was looking for contacts and agents in all strata.
But they were Marxist-Leninists, though. There aren't many Marxist-Leninists representing marginal Tory seats.
Yeah, I'm not saying that some Tory people were recruited, but I'm just denying that the KGB centered its attention on any political side of the spectrum.
Of course, there was all that speculation recently in the newspapers, and you were quoted the alleged smear, and a lot of people are saying it's a smear, that these meetings with Russian officials were misinterpreted by leading members of the Labour Party. Was it a smear?
It turned out that it was not a smear at all, because what was published in Sunday Times, it was all authentic stuff. They were quotations from the memoranda written by the Soviet ambassador, Mr. Popov, in London and sent to the International Department of the Central Committee in Moscow. So it was a genuine stuff. Really, Mr. Kinnock, Dennis Healy, other labor leaders visited the Russian embassy, spoke to the ambassador and other Soviet diplomats. It was all recorded and sent back to Moscow. But what they said actually to the Russian ambassador and other Russian diplomats, it was exactly what used to be their policy, their official and officially stated policy. That's why there is nothing incriminating in those records.
So it's a smear in so much as the hidden agenda is one that is designed to damage the Labour Party. And perhaps we could say that the journalists responsible for putting it in the newspaper in the first place, their motives weren't entirely unquestionable.
I don't know about it, but other newspapers, and I heard on the radio interviews with other chief editors of other papers, they all said if we had received such material, we would have published it as well. So it is not really an arguable thing whether it was an intention or not. Actually, it was quite interesting, even for me, to read those memos. Of course, I recognized many of them because it was most of it happened in my time, and yeah. I was very close to those people, the ambassador and his assistants. Why the panic was there, why the Labour Party panicked about it, because they knowing that Russian diplomats and Russian intelligence officers often exaggerate and fantasize and invent things about their contacts, they could have put in the memos whatever, a direct lie, and then it would have been very difficult to deny the lie.
Yes.
If there would have been
the signature of
the ambassador.
Yes.
It would, but it turned out that yes. It was all correct. It was exactly what they said, and it was what they said. It was a description of their defense policy in the early 80s.
Which was no secret.
It was no secret at all, because they spoke about it in the parliament, in all public places.
Do you think some of these leading Labour politicians were a bit naive about the Soviet Union?
It was not really naivety. I don't think they were naive. But what I found a bit, it was difficult for me to understand, that they felt that the Communist Party of the Soviet Union was somehow a kind of a distant relative to them. They didn't realize entirely that the Communist Party of Soviet Union was a sinister force in a totalitarian, centralized, dictatorial state. And the only thing it wanted, it was a more control over the territories and minds of the people in Western Europe and generally in the West. It was a chauvinistic force which had nothing to do with socialism or social justice and so on. They forgot about it. They didn't realize that the Communist Party of the Soviet Union, which used to be before the revolution and a democratic and social party, it had become a totalitarian force and nothing else.
They had a romantic image of it.
Romantic image, yes, exactly.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. My guest tonight is Oleg Gordievsky, former KGB colonel and double agent, and more in just a second. Oleg Gordievsky, former head of the KGB in London. So when did you start passing secrets the other way? When did you become a double agent?
Quite long ago. It happened in 1974, 75. And I was serving in Scandinavia at that time, in Denmark.
For money, was that?
No money at all. Money was not involved at all. Because I used to be a great idealist in the 60s, watching the developments in the Soviet Union, knowing everything about the crimes of communism and the KGB against the people, knowing the figures, how many people died in the concentration camps, something like 40 million. 40 million in the first 40, 50 years of Soviet power in Russia.
In Stalin's era.
In Stalin, mostly, yes. But even in the 60s, even under Khrushchev, some of the camps were full of political prisoners. And then, on the day of the invasion of Czechoslovakia by Soviet troops, I decided not to support that regime any longer. And I started to think what I can do against the regime and in order to help the West.
It must have been a very big decision to decide to become a traitor to your country.
No, it is not my country. KGB is not my country. Now, particularly after the events in August, practically no Russians identify the Communist Party of Soviet Union, and particularly not the KGB, with the country, with the people, with the Russian nation.
You saw it not as treachery to your country, but merely turning on the KGB.
Of course, I was traitor to KGB and the Communist Party of Soviet Union, but not to Russia. Because my objective was to help achieve democracy and freedom to Russia and the Russian people. Only in the mid-70s, already during my collaboration with Britain, the developments in Russia were so depressing. Era of stagnation. Mikhail Gorbachev called it very well. It was an era of stagnation. The stagnation was so profound that I thought there was no hope at all for Russia any longer. The only thought was for me to defend Britain and the United States and Western Europe, the Western world, against communist aggression.
My guest tonight, Oleg Gordievsky, former double agent, former KGB colonel. Here's Sting, former member of the police. You were a double agent. What was the nature of the information that you were actually passing to the West, to the NATO alliance countries? Because I would imagine you would have had access to some very interesting little memoranda.
Oh, numerous.
Yeah.
In the period of my collaboration with the British intelligence service, they were able to produce several hundreds, or if not thousands, of reports based on my my information, on me reporting to them about the Soviet intentions, KGB activities, KGB penetration, KGB plans, KGB contacts and agents in the Western society. Several thousands, I think.
Were they able
Not just that. After some time, I started to spirit out of the KGB's premises in under the roof of the embassy, authentic documents, KGB documents themselves, which was a great risk for life. So it was not just me telling them and briefing the British officials, but also producing real, authentic KGB documents.
Yes.
So I was able to collect quite a lot of them. And in this book, which is here on your desk.
This one here.
Which is called...
Instructions from the Center.
Yeah. I published some of those documents.
I know. Some of the documents are quite incredible. They really are. The stuff against Margaret Thatcher and so forth. Some of it's very badly done as well.
Yes. But the Russian KGB officers sitting in Moscow, yeah, they knew something about Britain, but not enough to write a sophisticated brochure about Margaret Thatcher in order to destroy her reputation. They were very naive, not very knowledgeable, making mistakes, and then sending the text of a brochure to one of the agents in Denmark to get it published. And that agent, instead of making more research and checking all the details, he just published like it was.
Yes.
There's also KGB mistakes in it. so you realize that KGB is often not very efficient and not very dangerous. The KGB was very dangerous, first of all, because it was so huge, because it had so many officers working inside the country
and
abroad.
Very clumsy and cumbersome as well, I would imagine,
yes,
too.
Yes, it was too.
Did any arrests result from your information passed to the British authorities? Any arrests of other spies?
Only three. It was one in Sweden, one in Norway, and it was Michael Betten in this country. Okay. I'm slightly, of course, worried about them because I don't want to have it on my conscience that there are people in jail because of my information.
But if they were working for an evil organization like the KGB, by your own moral standards, did they not deserve it?
Well, they deserved it, but now when, first of all, I feel whatever they did deserved it, but I feel uneasy about it, because I'm a human being, and I've got my conscience and my soul, and I feel a bit sad that some people like Arne Treholt is in jail.
But that was a decision you must have made years ago.
Yes, somebody said it is your cross to bear, and it is my cross. But I think now, then, when the Warsaw Pact has crumbled, and there is no communist ideology and no communist party any longer, and Mr. Yeltsin is saying we are friends, and let's build defense in space together with the Americans. Now I think it is time to rehabilitate of the spies.
There was millions of people who died in the camps, though. It's not going to bring them back to life, is it? You've got to think like that. But that's what you said a few minutes ago.
Yes, but it's a different story. It is a story about the leaders of the KGB, the most dangerous criminals who are responsible for the purges in the 50s against those innocent people who died in the camps. They are old men, pensioners back in the Soviet Union. The question is, should we prosecute them or not? Because it's the same question which is being asked in this country. Should we still prosecute Nazi criminals or not? If we should prosecute Nazi criminals, let's prosecute those KGB butchers who are still alive, mm-hmm, and who continued working and prosecuting, making people suffer, not until 45, but until 53.
Yes. Obviously, you think we should prosecute them.
No, I'm not so sure about it. They're so old now, we should forgive and forget about it. And the Russian society has gone through so much suffering.
Open wounds
and brutalize the society even more. So we should not have too many courts and too many people in jail again. The same question is being asked, what should we do with the Communist Party of the Soviet Union?
Yes, yes. Because we're doing a witch hunt's the last thing that is wanted, isn't it?
Yes.
With me is Oleg Gordievsky. When you were a double agent, you must have had to be absolutely diligently careful, assiduous in every way that you weren't seen when you were actually meeting British officials and passing documents. Were those meetings terribly secretive?
Yes, they were. They were. In Copenhagen, there was a safe apartment rented for me, to meet me and to debrief me. And each time I went there, I had to watch out carefully whether the KGB was following me somehow. My own KGB colleagues could have noticed it, yes, and reported about me to the KGB boss or to Moscow, and would have been the end.
So you were always looking over your shoulder? Always.
Yes. Yeah. And the same in London. And in London, even worse, because the atmosphere in the Soviet embassy in London and in the KGB station was even more sinister and more unpleasant than it was used to be in Copenhagen during my previous postings. Yeah. So I had to be on guard against all my KGB colleagues all the time. And many times the situation was critical. But each time I was able to do it clandestinely enough.
Yeah.
But anyway, They found out about me.
Well, we'll talk about that in a minute. They did find out. You were summoned home. You went home, but you were in fact tricked into going home. And we'll find out all about that after we've heard from the Beatles. Well, I find out lucky to be back in the USSR at all. Oleg Gordievsky, who's with me tonight, written the book Instructions from the Center, former KGB colonel and double agent. You've been working as a double agent for years. You summoned back by your Soviet paymasters, your KGB bosses, and they'd find out about you.
Yes, in May 1985, they found out about me. How? I don't know.
You still don't know?
I still don't know. And that is a bit sinister, how it happened. One important general in the KGB later, when already I knew I was found out, and I knew that I was probably going to die, he, playing with me like a cat with a mouse, he said, "Mr. Gordievsky, if you only knew from what a peculiar source we have learned about you being a traitor to us." And now, nearly 7 years after that conversation, we still don't know who was that peculiar source. But anyway, in May 85, they summoned me to Moscow, allegedly for important talks with important KGB bosses, including Mr. Chebrikov himself, head of the KGB. So I arrived in Moscow, and very soon I realized it was a trap. A few days later, I was taken to a little cottage outside the main KGB compound, allegedly for an important conversation with some officials, and I was given a drink containing a very high-toxic KGB-developed drug. And immediately, I felt I was a different person.
In what way?
I was hot, excited, I talked a lot, and I was prepared to speak about everything, to reveal, open my soul, my heart, and so on, and talked and chatted, and got involved in a heated conversation with my interrogators. Later I realized that I hadn't confessed, because their main objective was to make me confess, point one, and to record it, and secondly, to receive more evidence. More details.
And names, maybe.
Maybe names. Who was running me and how and who recruited me and so on. And I didn't confess. And I never said anything incriminating against myself. It is really like a miracle. Why I didn't? Probably because I had expecting all the time arrest.
This may seem like a strange question, but why didn't they torture you?
Because the torture was banned in the KGB. When
really?
When the Stalin died, and Nikita Khrushchev had carried out his destalinization of the Soviet society, including the KGB, the torture was forbidden to use. So they only were permitted to use drugs, which is a mild form of torture. Yes. My torture was the use of drug.
So how did
it was not so bad.
So how did you escape after that? How did you actually manage to defect to the West?
Because they failed to extract the crucial evidence out from me, they decided to let me be free in Moscow, moving around in Moscow, in my flat, in the streets, of course terminating my posting in London and evacuating my family from London. I noticed surveillance, physical surveillance behind me in the streets of Moscow. I knew that my flat was bugged. I was under observation all the time. Probably there was a television camera watching me even in my flat. But they wanted me to make a mistake, either to get in touch with the British Secret Service or making some other silly move. But I, realizing that the only chance for me to survive, not to die, but to survive, was to escape, to flee Russia, to cross physically the Russian border.
And you didn't tell your wife you were doing it, did you?
I didn't tell my wife because I didn't want to involve her in it. I knew that I had to abandon, for a time being, my wife and the children, because it was impossible to have my two small children and wife crossing physically the Russian border, which is in the fortification of a border, with minefields and so on. That's why it would have been stupid to tell my wife, because the KGB would have interrogated my wife. Later they did, of course, interrogated her.
So how did you actually physically escape?
I took a train. I shook off the surveillance, took train, already KGB not knowing that, in the western direction, towards the western border of Soviet Union, reached the border area and started to move using commuter trains, bus, and walking, hiding. I moved towards the border to cross it. But it was impossible to cross the border on my own. It was impossible. And I did have a plan how to cross it with some assistance. So, yes, I can confess to you that I did have some assistance. Some people helped me to cross the border in the crucial point, just when I, on my own, reached the border area.
People from the West?
Yes. It was a very complicated, very difficult operation. I think that the chances that I was able to cross it, not being caught by the KGB, was 1 in 20.
What was the nature of this operation? Why was it so complicated?
Just to cross the Russian border, cross the Soviet border, which is heavily fortified.
How was it done?
I can't tell you the details. It's still a secret. It's very sensitive.
Why?
Why? Because methods are used there. The operational aspects of it, they are a secret.
But the Cold War's over.
Well, not entirely over, because the Soviet borders, Russian borders, Ukrainian borders are still the same, and the border guard troops are still there. And there are other states like the Soviet Union, and there might be other Western assistants working in the heart of the totalitarian societies in North Korea, in China, in Cuba, in Vietnam. They might need help to get them out, to spirit them out of those countries one day. So all the same methods will be used to get them out, to save their life, and maybe life of their families. Yes, it is a secret. Sorry, I can't tell you, it's a very important secret.
Well, we'll have to use our imaginations on that one.
Yes. Maybe one day I will be able to invite me in a couple of years again to your program, so maybe I will tell you the more details of how I physically crossed the border.
The mind is boggling. Oleg Gordievsky with me tonight. More in just a second. Here's Elton John. Gordievsky with me tonight. Instructions from the Centre, written with the journalist Christopher Andrew. Top secret files on KGB foreign operations 1975 to 1985. It's a cracking good read, and it's a real spy story. Oleg was, if you've just joined me, a double agent for many years and a KGB colonel, the KGB's top man in this country. He has defected, but your wife remained in the Soviet Union. You hadn't even told her. Said, I'm off out for a few minutes, darling, and you didn't tell her you were actually defecting, because you couldn't tell her, because as soon as she knew, she was then sensitive, because she had that information.
Yeah, exactly.
And that put her in danger.
Yes.
It must have been so painful, knowing that she was there and thinking that perhaps you would never see her again, because you weren't to know that the system would crumble and the Soviet Union would be no more.
No, of course I didn't. No, not at all. And at that time, in 85, the system appeared so strong, so powerful. It looked as if it would go forever, year after year. So the only hope for me was either a strong political pressure by the West, British and American leaders asking Mr. Gorbachev to release my family, or maybe some complex spy swap.
Did Mrs. Thatcher help you?
Yes, they did. Mrs. Thatcher and John Major and President Reagan and President Bush, they all asked Mikhail Gorbachev to release the family. And always, each time he was asked, he said no.
Why?
Answering no, because the KGB told him to say so. So in this respect, he was entirely under KGB's influence, and they held them as hostages. It is really a shame.
Did you phone her?
In the beginning, it was not possible to phone her. I didn't phone. I was not able to send parcels. I sent parcels, money, and telegrams, and they all were returned because the KGB organized that nothing would reach her. But later on, when the situation started to relax slightly, I was able to phone her. And in the last 1.5 years, before their release, I started to speak on the phone to her, and it helped a lot, of course.
And you had two daughters. How old were they at the beginning?
When we got separated, they were 4 and 5 years old. Now they are 10 and 11 years old. And of course, when I was leaving, abandoning them back in Russia, it was extremely painful for me, because I was so much in love with my family, my wife and my two small children. They were so important for me. It was a double pain, of course. The KGB knew it. That's why they enjoyed the situation.
Oh, yes. Well, after you had defected, when you were in this country, did you have regrets about leaving them? Did you perhaps think, well, maybe I should have stayed with them?
No, I knew I was going to die. I knew that if I had stayed back in the Soviet Union, the KGB would have arrested me, and I knew even when, about at what time I would have been arrested, about 3 weeks after the date of my escape, in the beginning of August 85. And having arrested me, they would have shot me, executed. Not the slightest doubt that I would have been executed. Of what help and use would I have been to the family being dead? So I decided it's better to leave them for a few years, or how many years, I didn't know. But at least I would be alive and would be able to try to help them. And it was the case. In the first couple of years, I was not able to help. But then I started to help. And eventually we got them out. And it was not the political pressure. It was strong political pressure. And I'm very thankful to Margaret Thatcher and John Major and the American presidents who tried to get them out. And there was no spy swap, because there was not a single KGB spy of any significance to swap for my family. I was not lucky here, but it, now the, what helped me was the change of the political situation in Russia.
The day that you found out the news that your wife and family were to come over here must have been a very, very joyous day for you.
Yes, it was the best day, maybe the best day of my life. So I'm thinking the day when I learned about it, on the day when I met them actually arriving from Moscow.
After 6 years, did your daughters remember you?
My only one daughter, the second daughter, who was 1 year younger, was not able to remember me at all. And they remembered me, obviously, very different, because they were disappointed that I was so short. So what?
Yeah, exactly, so yeah. What? And how have they settled in the UK?
Very well now. They spent the first 2-3 months learning English, and now they joined a school, and now they are even weekly boarders, staying in their school for 5 days each week.
How's their English?
Their English improving all the time. It is not adequate yet to take in everything they get during the lessons, but it's adequate enough to speak to their friends, other girls in the school.
What about the old Soviet indoctrination that may well have rubbed off on them in their early school years? Is that still there?
In the last 2-3 years, the indoctrination started to diminish in the schools. So they're not indoctrinated in the traditional communist spirit. It's good. But there are, of course, some behavior which is determined by the realities of the Russian life rather than by the English life. So they have to change a bit, some manners, some way how they speak, how they joke, but it will come.
And how did your wife like this country?
My wife likes it very much. She spent the first the 3 years, 82-85, as wife of a so-called diplomat, because I was intelligence
officer.
She's
been here before.
She knows the country, but we lived in, used to live in London, and she liked London very much. Now I live in the countryside. And in the beginning, the first couple of weeks, she thought it was too isolated and too quiet and too peaceful there. And now she realized that it was happiness to live in the beautiful English countryside.
What about the bad side of this country and the downside of capitalism? People, you know, the huge unemployment, people sleeping on the streets, all the social problems that we get.
The fact it is, it means very little for the Russians, because the Russian problems, the problems of Russia and other former Soviet republics, are so much worse, so much more serious, much more profound, that your problems with all your unemployment and with all your homeless, they are nothing compared with the brutalities and deprivations of the Russian life. That we just make jokes about it, because we know that all the unemployed people, they have enough food. While the Russian people, even having jobs and having earning some money, they are not able to buy food because there is no food in the shops. And there are also many people who are homeless, and nobody is able to provide them with accommodation. There are families, 3-4 families with children living in one flat. It's the communists brought the country to such a pathetic state that it is there is no comparison at all with Britain.
Well, Oleg Gordievsky, it's a fantastic story. Thanks very much for coming in and talking about it tonight. I've really enjoyed it. The book is Instructions from the Center by Christopher Andrew and Oleg Gordievsky, Top Secret Files on KGB Foreign Operations. And I know you're working on your autobiography at the moment, aren't you?
Yes, I am.
So that I'm sure we'll see it on the big screen before too much longer as well.
Yes, I hope so. Maybe.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.